Coming up, we take a look at Azure Active Directory B2B collaboration, now generally available, a new service that helps simplify the secure sharing of your apps and services with your business partners. We'll show you how it enables your partners to bring their own identity to securely access your corporate resources without you having to manage their identities, whether or not they have Azure Active Directory in place. We'll also show you how it allows you to build custom collaboration experiences with our Microsoft Graph APIs while allowing you to focus on protecting company data through conditional access policies, including multi-factor authentication enabled by Azure Active Directory. So I'm joined by Sarat from the Azure AD team. Welcome to the show.
Great to be on the show, Simon.
So congratulations, we've hit a major milestone. Azure AD B2B has gone general availability. You actually recently transitioned from the SharePoint team. How's that helped you with building Azure AD B2B?
It's been immensely helpful. So SharePoint Online was about easy and secure external collaboration on files and sites. We learned a lot there. But most modern businesses need external partners to work on more than files and sites. With Azure Active Directory B2B, we are bringing collaboration into the identity fabric, and that enables it for thousands of applications integrated with Azure Active Directory. Let me show you what that means. So here I am, signed in as John, and I work with the Woodgrove Corporation. We are a large consumer goods company with a worldwide distribution network, and we use Azure Active Directory for the tens of thousands of people inside and outside the company with valid needs to access our system. But we work with external partners who help with supply chain management and logistics. Some of these are small companies that don't even have an IT department. Using Azure Active Directory B2B, we can easily give these users access to key applications and keep all our plans, intellectual properties safe in the Azure AD protected environment. So here I am, signed in as Audrey, one of our supply chain experts from a company that does not have an IT department. As you can see, Audrey signed in with her Gmail address, and yet, she has access to all the applications that she needs for her work with the Woodgrove Corporation. And all of this is because of Azure Active Directory B2B collaboration.
That's interesting. I've not seen that before with a consumer email address like Gmail.
We have separated the account from the identity so that the user can continue to use any identity, their personal identity in this case, but my organization can still keep Azure Active Directory authorization policies in place so that my content is safe.
So this isn't a new requirement or a new concept. How have people done this in the past?
Well, businesses have always needed to work with other businesses to be successful. Mm-hmm. But the old way was to create accounts and manage passwords for these external users. Let me show you an example of this happening. So we are signed in to the F128 photography company, and they work with a number of different users from different companies, like Contoso Pictures, Litware Corp, Wingtip Toys, etc. Here you can see Abby Spencer from the Contoso Pictures actually has a user account in the F128 organization with a display name that says that she's from Contoso Pictures and a username that matches. This is so that users in the F128 organization know that Abby is from a different company, mm-hmm. and so that they can maintain policies. But see, this is a problem for the administrator who has to keep up with the changing roles and even Abby leaving for the company.
And worse still, don't some solutions actually try and synchronize those accounts from the on-premises directory into Azure Active Directory, and it all gets a bit complicated to make single sign-on work?
That's exactly right. So single sign-on is very important to get right. So organizations go to a number of extremes to get this done. But if I'm running a large business, it will be very invasive for my org and my partner org. It's an unreasonably high bar for me to ask an independent, unaffiliated organization to sync their users into our directory. But the good news is that's the old way of doing things.
Okay, great. Let's get into how you've actually made this better with Azure Active Directory B2B.
Let me show you. I'm signed in as John Doe in the Woodgrove organization that I just told you about. Now, I'm not an IT administrator. I'm a floor manager, and I'm responsible for our retail store's supply chain. So I can go to the Salesforce ERP application where we do supply management, hit the Manage App option. So I'm going to go and hit the plus button, and I'm going to add you, Simon. But your organization does not have an IT department. So I'm going to type in simonumay@gmail.com because that's how we work together. And I'm going to include a personalized message so you know it's from me. Great, and that's from John. And I hit add. And what that does is sends you an invitation and adds you to the Salesforce application.
Okay, so should we switch over to my email and take a look at what that looks like?
Let's do that.
Okay, so if I go in here and take a look in the email, I can see that, yep, it's come from Grove, and it's got your photo there, so I know that it's come from the right place, and the message is in there as well. So let me hit the Get Started, and that's going to take me across to Azure AD.
So that's a welcome message from Woodgrove, and...
Yep, I'll hit Next.
Great. At this point, we just ask you to create a password for that social account that you're using, and hit Next. And this will send you a code to your email, just so we can verify that it's indeed you.
Okay, I'll go grab that code and copy and paste it into the right place inside of the Azure AD sign-in screen. There we go.
Perfect.
And done, I'll hit Next.
And that's really it. So at this point of time, we are just preparing your account, and we'll take you to the Access Panel page.
So what just happened there? How did that work?
Well, you used a consumer domain. Mm-hmm. And so for that, we created a consumer account for you in the Microsoft account system. In the future, we will be federating directly with identity providers like Google so that users like you can get seamless single sign-on into my organization.
Okay, so that works if I'm a freelancer and I'm using consumer email. What about if I've got a business email address, but I don't have Azure Active Directory?
So let's imagine that you had a business account with Contoso Logistics, who do our warehousing and distribution. Your company does not have Azure Active Directory, mm-hmm. but it has an IT department, so you have a managed email address. So now I'm going to just add you to the Salesforce application with your IT managed email account. Let's say it's simon@contosologistics.com. And I'm going to click Add. So that should send you an email.
OK, I've got it. I'm going to go on, click on the Get Started link.
Great. So now you see that landing page again. You hit Next, and you're prompted to create a password. And because you're using a business identity, we create a business account for you in Azure Active Directory. And you land on the App Access panel, and you can click on Salesforce.
Oh, that's cool. I'm getting single sign-on directly into Salesforce.
That's exactly right. And so this allows you to work on any application that I collaborate with you, no matter what identity you're using. Now, you notice that we created a password for you. Mm-hmm. That was because your account did not exist in Azure Active Directory yet, so we just created a quick one there and created a password that you could manage. But in the future, we will federate with other standards-based, SAML-based identity providers so that you'd get single signed on from your on-premises identity provider.
So in both cases, sign-on was actually pretty painless. So I guess the point that you're making is that organizations can set authorization policies regardless of how the user is signing in.
Exactly. We are shifting the focus of the organizations from worrying about how their partners sign in to protecting their data through the powerful authorization policies that are powered by Azure Active Directory. This means controlling what the users are permitted to access, what they can do with that access, and the additional criteria they need to gain access. So really, we offer complete peace of mind for IT.
So what did Woodgrove IT need to do to set this up?
Let's take a look. Here I'm signed in as Allison, the IT administrator of Woodgrove. First, to enable the scenario where I added you and your organizational identity to Salesforce, as an IT administrator, I've already created a group for Salesforce access. I'm calling it the External Partner Salesforce Group. I'll make my persona, John Doe, the owner of this group. And there it is. I've assigned that owner. Now, let me switch over to Salesforce, and I'm going to add this group into Salesforce, which will enable the Salesforce application for external collaboration. Again, I go to the Users and Groups option. I'll click on Add. Select the Users and Groups option here. Search for that External Partners Salesforce Group, and I'm going to assign it to the Salesforce application. And then I'm going to go and select a role to which users who are added in that group can be assigned. I'm just going to pick chatter-free user, but I could pick any of these other roles that Salesforce supports. And I'm going to hit Assign now. So that's it. So what I've done is added John Doe as the owner of a group that I've now assigned to the Salesforce application.
So this covers how users can safely get through the front door and access the resources that you defined. But what if I want to take a more sophisticated check on who's actually coming into the network, what network locations they're coming from, and maybe even enforce multi-factor authentication?
Well, with Azure Active Directory B2B, you have the unique capability of applying conditional access policies for external users as well. Mm-hmm. So we are extending the Azure Active Directory protection umbrella to partner relationships too. Let's take a look. I'm signed in here as Allison, the IT administrator of Woodgrove again. And I'm going to go to the conditional access policies for Salesforce. I add a new policy. I call it the Salesforce MFA policy. I go down to target users and groups that should respect these policies. Let's go down and look at the conditions as well. I'm going to leave all of this blank for now, but I could have configured the appropriate locations or the devices, etc., that the users are coming in and target those specific cases. But let's just go down and grant access. I'm going to require multi-factor authentication, and this converts this policy into an MFA policy. I hit enable the policy, and that's it. Now all the business-to-business collaboration users that are coming in are going to have to do MFA as they access Salesforce.
So I've actually got one of those users set up right here. So let me just go into the portal here, and I'm going to go into my Salesforce app that you provided me earlier. And I see that I get to the Azure AD page, and it's actually asking me to set up multi-factor authentication.
Absolutely.
That's pretty slick. In these examples, you're actually adding one user at a time, though. What if Woodgrove doesn't know ahead of time who needs to access their system? Do we support that kind of a scenario?
Yeah, indeed. That's a very common scenario. And using our APIs, we do. Let's say John Doe did not know ahead of time that he needed to add another partner from your company. But he had that other partner, Jeff, had the URL for Woodgrove Online for the B2B portal. So at this point of time, Jeff can come in and sign up for access to Woodgrove, and Woodgrove can do policy-based onboarding of that user to the right applications. And there it is. Jeff's request has come in. I'm just going to approve it. And that should send an email to Jeff. Great. And there's my onboarding instructions from Woodgrove. So signed in as Jeff, I can click on Get Started. I see the landing page. I'm going to click Next. Remember, I also did not have an Azure Active Directory account. So here I easily create one. And in the future, it's going to be single sign-on. I get a verification code again. I input my verification code. And that lands me on the Woodgrove application access panel. So even without being manually onboarded by an administrator in the organization, I was able to get policy-based access to all the applications that my org needed to in order to work successfully with Woodgrove. And I could do self-service onboarding.
So that was really cool. How easy was that for Woodgrove to actually set up?
It took a couple of hours. We took instructions that we have already published as part of the Azure Active Directory B2B Collaboration API documentation that you can see here. And we've actually even produced that sample code and published it on GitHub. So an organization that's interested in trying that self-service scenario up could just click on Deploy to Azure. They can deploy this application into a subscription of their choice and customize it, modify it for their organizational needs.
Everything you've shown us has been really, really cool, but they've all been experiences with non-Microsoft apps. I actually assume that this just works with Office 365.
Absolutely. So Office 365 Groups already supports inherently the B2B capabilities that we are producing in Azure Active Directory, as well as those B2B users can get seamless access into SharePoint applications. And we are working every day closely with Office 365 application teams to make sure this is an integrated part of all the Office 365 applications.
Okay, I guess the one final thing then is, do IT admins actually get any insight into what's happening inside of their organizations? I know people are going to want that.
Absolutely. So let me show you. Here again, I am Allison. You can see that John Doe invited Simon, and that Simon accepted that invitation at a given time. In fact, I can even go to the sign-in logs, and I can see all the applications that Simon has accessed. And so just like with internal users, you'd be able to get all the information about what external users are doing in your organization. In addition, if the partner organization is on Azure Active Directory, they can also tell what their users are doing with their identities outside the organization.
Sarah, that was a great overview. It's a lot simpler to enable external collaboration across your apps and services for both users and for IT. What are you going to be working on next?
So we saw today how it is possible to add individual users from partner companies. But most businesses work with roles in other partner companies, and they want those partner companies to manage the memberships into those roles. So we are going to create experiences where the partner company can manage memberships, and you don't have to have the headache of that lifecycle management. And in addition to that, we're going to do a ton of work in the governance features like access reviews, periodic email verifications, sponsorships, et cetera, et cetera.
Very cool. So how can these guys actually try Azure AD B2B?
This feature set is available for all Azure AD customers. If you have Office 365, EMS, Intune, or any service on Azure, you can start using it today. And you can learn more on the link below.
Thank you very much for joining us on the show today, and congrats again for the GA milestone. Don't forget to keep watching Microsoft Mechanics for the latest updates. We'll see you next time.